David is a very well-known man at Burning Man. He is the for those of you who don't know Burning Man, I mean, those of you that do know Burning Man know who he is. Those of you who don't, he builds these exquisite temples. It takes you all year long, right, to build them, and then gives them as a gift to the participants as a kind of ritual of release, like the man, similar to the man, but in a different way, and I'm sure you'll talk about that. Just releasing it, and it's burnt. So I think that's all I'm going to really say about that, and I'll let you speak a little bit about your work, and I'm just going to introduce Joshua, but we'll let you go first and just speak a little bit about your work, and then Joshua will speak a little bit about his work, and then we're going to open it up to a dialogue with Charles about gifting. So Joshua is another burner, and he is an artist, and he's creator of this project called The Gift Prolific. And you gave a gift every day for a year, right? You created a small painting, and you gave it away. And you had this whole transformative experience as a result of that, as I understand. So I'm looking forward to hearing your story as well. So I'm going to go ahead and hand it over to you two, starting with David. And you have a mic right there. You can turn it on.
Okay. Is it on? So this guy walks into a bar, and he's like, pretty drunk, and he looks at the bartender and says, come on, buddy. I'm not going to serve you. You've had too much to drink. So the guy walks outside and comes in the side door, looking at the bartender. God damn it, buddy. I told you two times you're not going to get a drink. Now hit the road. Guy goes in the back door, comes up, looks at the bartender. Three times I've told you out of the bar. Now, this is it. I'm not going to serve you. You're too drunk. How many bars do you work in? All right. So Coyote gave me that joke. He's the guy that sets up the event, does all the groundwork at the Playa. When Larry Harvey told me that the event was going to go from the bartering to the gift economy, it pissed me off. All right, I had a big bar car, and I used to trade poems for drinks. It was always fun to have someone trade you something. And I didn't like the gift idea at all. I thought it was bullshit. And we were working on the temple, and I had built this large temples in the desert, and I had like, I think, 12 altars in it. And one of the altars had a long poem on it. And it was, I have a gun, it's under my bed, I've seen the rockets coming in, I've done a lot of things, I have a gun, it's under my bed. And it kept recurring poem. And underneath it was a note, a card that said Hector had finally took the gun out from underneath his bed and committed suicide. And it was a Vietnam era suicide note. This person had it for whenever Vietnam was. And they brought that note and put it on the altar. And that was a gift. And I went, oh. Now I finally got the idea of a gift. It wasn't, another keychain or a Burning Man cigarette lighter or a black and white feather. It was a suicide note. And the gifts that, I don't give a lot of gifts. You make it like I make a temple for other people. There's thousands of people have come and shared with me that their son committed suicide, that their mother committed suicide, that many things. Those are gifts. That when I'm in an airport and I sit down and talk to someone and you look at them and they go, what's wrong with you? And their father committed suicide. The fact that someone shares with me or with any of us, and I don't say any of us because a lot of people don't want to talk to someone at an airport about someone's father committing suicide. But that gift that person shares with me is like beyond anything I could ever give to anybody else. So working with a crew, I've worked with in excess of 10,000 people. And it can actually be documented how many people I've worked with. I've worked with 12,000 people, or 1,200 people in Pittsburgh. And, you know, I have big crews that I work with. And I'll have maybe 100 people working for me or with me. And like one guy, for instance, came up an hour after the work party was meeting. We were going to meet on Saturday at 12 o'clock, and he came at 1 o'clock. And he apologized for being late. He said, I missed my bus. The reality was, is he had to panhandle money to get the bus fare. He didn't have any money. You know, and I said, don't ever apologize to me for coming late to work again. You know, he was working for me or with us for free. I'm not a real gifter kind of personality, but the people that I work with are. You know, we have 100 different people coming from all over the country to come and work for 6 months to build a temple. And they build the temple, and I guess you'd say it's a gift because at the end we burn it. It's too many people bring their pictures of their people that they've lost. They bring ashes. You know, I brought my parents' ashes and put it in there. So, but this is my second rough speech. I did one the other day that was a real flopper too. So, you know, I mean, this is it. I don't have anything else to say.
Keep your keepers. I got my own.
All right, that's he's a tough act to follow.
Do a joke.
Okay, I got another bar joke. So this old man walks into a bar. And he looks at the bartender and he says, I'll have 3 pints of Guinness. Bartender's like, I could just pour them out like all three at the same time. He says, absolutely, 3 pints of Guinness. So he pours out the 3 pints of Guinness. The guy drinks them. He leaves. He comes back the next day. The bartender says, hey. He goes, hey, 3 pints of Guinness. Bartender's like, that is so weird. Pours them out. The guy sits and drinks them. He leaves. This happens every day for a week. Finally, the bartender says, hey, man, what is with the 3 pints of Guinness? He goes, oh, I've got 2 brothers back in Ireland, and we said whenever you sit down to have a pint of Guinness, go ahead and have one for each of the brothers. Oh, that's really cute, man. I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to pry. It's none of my business. Here's your 3 pints of Guinness. The man doesn't come back for 8-9 days. Bartender's like, man, I wonder what happened to him. Maybe I was too nosy. Something happened. Finally, the old man comes in. The bartender is relieved to see him. He says, hey, 3 pints of Guinness? He goes, no, 2 pints of Guinness. Bartender's like, oh, no. He waits for a little bit, pours out his 2 pints of Guinness. He walks out of the bar, and he says, hey, did something happen to one of your brothers? Did one of them pass away? He goes, oh, no. I quit drinking. I tried. So my name is Joshua Coffy. I'm an artist living and working in San Francisco. And in early 2011, I had my own bout with just being maxed out on everything in my life and being super depressed. And I was on the edge of suicide on a daily basis. I couldn't really figure out what was going on. I have a fantastic, loving wife and an awesome little kid, and you know, but it just was so much pressure that I really didn't have a lot of answers for a lot of the things that were right in front of me. And in my search to sort of get out of that spot, I started to think of things that made me feel good on a regular basis. And one of the things that has always been something that I felt I cherished in my life was an aspect of giving, especially like at Burning Man. I've been a part of different things where you give things or give trinkets or you do sort of the thing, and I really enjoyed that. And I thought, well, I can maybe do that in my daily life and see if that sort of helped me dig out of the incredible funk that I was under. And so I started doing just really small gifts. I think one of the first ones I made pancakes for a really good friend of mine. And it was just, it just felt good. And I sort of wrote about it and thought, oh, that was really fun. Maybe tomorrow I'll do something else for somebody else. And I bought flowers for a complete stranger. And, you know, it sort of started to build. And on Burn Night 2011, I decided to make a project where I would give a gift away every single day or do something nice for somebody every day. Then I would go home and make a small painting about each day's gift. I wanted to sort of be a better artist. And at the time, I really didn't know what I was going to do with all those paintings. And I thought, I don't know if I can even get past a week, you know, and pull this whole thing off. But I wanted to give it the old college try. And about a month in, I decided that I was going to take all the paintings, a year's worth of paintings and a year's worth of gifts to Burning Man, and build a huge gallery of all the paintings. And I did that on Burn Day, well, the day before Burn Night on 2012. We had a gallery opening at Burning Man. Some people are here tonight that got a painting. Some of the people that are here waited 3.5 hours to get a painting. I gave all the paintings away as gifts themselves. The trick with the painting is that if you got one of them, you could look on the back and there's a reference number and you can go to my website and read about the original gift story that inspired your painting. So it has a little bit of a layer to it. And I won't say that it like completely cured my depression issue or sort of made things, you know, all super happy better. The thing that it did, that little bit of, I don't know, time, like 5 minutes every day that if I felt like crap, I could fight back a little bit. And that daily giving sort of made that muscle a lot stronger. So by the end of the year, you know, if I was automatically having a bad day or something, it was like, even my wife teases me, like, you know what you should be doing right now, like, go do something for somebody. You know, so it completely changed my entire life around. And it was a huge thank you to all the things that have sort of happened to me, especially something like David's Temple has influenced my project. And other things that have happened at Burning Man have really kind of made me take that home into a very real-world sense. And I am not doing the project right now currently, but I do giving every single day. And I do focus on what can I do to sort of do something for somebody every day. And it's really made a big difference. So that's my story.
Now it's, well, is it working? Sort of. Okay. A joke. Okay. So this guy shows up at the hospital, and his ears are really badly burned. And the doctor says, the doctor treats him, and he says, I'm like, you know, what did you do to your ears? How did this happen? And I said, well, it's kind of embarrassing, but I was ironing my shirts, and the phone rang. So instead of grabbing the phone, I put the iron right up to my ear. And the doctor said, yeah, that is, haven't heard that one before, but what about your other ear? I said, well, after I did that, I had to call 911.
Damn it.
Okay, what's the next one?
Okay, I got to add one because you all did. The bartender said, we don't serve time travelers here. A time traveler walks into the bar. Short and sweet. So this is where we get to field your questions to our wonderful panel. And we have a question over there already, looks like. Does somebody want to? Actually, if you have a question, maybe it would be easy if you just walked up to the microphone. And the preference is, because we have very limited time, that your questions be questions. And just if you could make them concise and directed to the panel, that would be great. Thanks.
So actually, I didn't formulate a question ahead of time, but I will try to be precise. So one of my main turnoffs about movements in general is that, and I heard it reflected actually in all of you who were talking, and I just want to point out, it's not something bad or anything like that, it just doesn't resonate with me, is that I think that in my worldview, you know, everybody has their own perspective, there's 1% that's totally fucking screwed up. And that's what we're focused on and we think about, and it looks really, really, really big. Fukushima, all this crap. And it feels like that's where, like, political movements and movements in general are focused. And I noticed, like, my daughter, she got a degree in sustainable business planning and environmental planning. But she's not attracted to working with any of the organizations because they're so focused on what's wrong. And it's totally unappealing to me. And so I just want to hear, what's your perspective on this? Because you guys are immersed in it. I mean, you're immersed in it. And you even, you know, you talked about, like, reading articles about how bad the Pacific Ocean is. And I understand, because I've got the going by on Facebook, too. And it's always tempting. It's like, oh, am I going to go look? Or am I really going to focus on what is happening? What's the positive part? So anyway, it's the one, I think it's like 1% or less that's really, and that we're looking at the tail end of the elephant and saying, God, that elephant's made out of a tail, and we're missing the rest of the 99%. So anyway, I just want to hear, how do you feel like that fits into all of this?
Thank you.
Something about an elephant. I don't know what the hell that's about, you know? I have a new race car that I just got. I'm going to go 230 miles an hour at Bonneville, the Salt Flats. So I feel pretty good about that. You know, I'm not completely uptight. You know, I mean, I love the idea of, I'm just willing to talk to someone about it. I think, you know, one of the things I tried teaching the people that I work with is, all you have to do is be embarrassed. That's all you have to do. You know, you talk to someone, you know, did your father commit suicide, or your daughter, your kids are on heroin, you know, and they say, what the fuck, you mind your own business. Okay. You just get embarrassed. But it doesn't freak me out. I don't go home and go, God, these people are talking to me about their sons committing suicide. I'm not a morbid person. I like going to Bonneville and racing a car and going real fast. So I don't focus on that 1%. I mean, Fukushima is a challenge for me. I'm excited. I want to go to Fukushima and build a temple. You know, it doesn't freak me out. You know, the carbon thing kind of freaks me out because these guys seem to be on a bandwagon about it. You know, I don't know what the hell they're talking about, all the carbon stuff. Let's just get down and work. Okay? So I don't focus on the statistics. You know, and kind of the thing that the guy back there was saying, you know, why don't we get together and be friends and exchange phone numbers and all that? You know, you want to do something, you get about 10 people together and start building something, you know. And, you know, you don't have to bullshit about being friends and stuff. Just start working, you know. You don't have to do that other thing, you know. Just go out and work, you know. And the woman here, a young lady, I can't pronounce your name, but in French, it's Pearl. How's that? I told her to just get illegal, you know. Don't ask permission from the goddamn government to build something. Just get illegal. Forge the papers, you know. I mean, you can go get a book, you know, print your own book and have a picture of you and Obama on it building a park. And then, I'm friends with the President of the United States, and I'm going to build a goddamn park in your neighborhood. See that? Building inspectors are going to be intimidated by a picture of Obama and yourself. Photoshop, you know, come on. Right. You okay? I'm not being unkind with you, and I'm not uptight about it. You know, I mean, I think, you know, that, you know, we all are trying to figure out what the hell to do with this stuff, you know. I mean, it pisses us off, you know. But we have to kind of, you know, that's why we have the jokes.
what could I add to that, you know?
Another joke.
Yeah, you know, there's like that secret part of me, or maybe not very secret part of me, that loves anything illegal just because it's illegal. Like, that's already like one, you know, like that's one thing in its favor. But you know, like the stuff about the, to me, it's not just 1% that's all messed up. I mean, I've spent my whole life wondering, well, I spent the first half of my life wondering what the source of this wrongness is that I feel every day in every place. Like, there was a part of me when I was in school that knew that you're not supposed to hate Monday, but everybody hated Monday, and that's not normal. But it was unquestioned. You know, and just like life is supposed to be more beautiful and more joyful and more authentic than what was offered me as normal. Like, I knew that. And what is wrong around here? Even when I was being bullied in 7th and 8th grade, I still kind of loved it when the kids like broke the rules and did bad stuff, you know, and set off a stink bomb in the bathroom, you know, and like,
yeah,
you know, like
fire.
Yeah. But I, you know, I think like, you know, like I read about stuff like Fukushima or something like that sometimes. It's not like so I can wallow in the grief, you know, and wallow in the despair and stuff like that. It kind of keeps me honest. It reminds me of, I don't know, it keeps me honest somehow. Thinking of, I was just telling Magali in the car about this friend of mine whose son died in a car accident. He was like 16 or 17, I think, 17 years old. And he and his wife just, you know, after the son died, they just went through this period of tremendous grief, like being at the bottom of a well 1,000 miles deep, from which there was no escape. Until they came through the other side completely transformed. And it took a long time. But I know that if they had avoided that grief by, I don't know, taking antidepressants, you know, because they went to a psychiatrist and he said, well, you should be over it by now and you're not being functional in society, then they wouldn't have come through the other side. Like, there's a lot that needs to be seen and needs to be grieved, I think. But that's just my opinion. But it doesn't make me less optimistic or less active, that's for sure.
I'll just add something really quick. I think David was kind of touching on it. When stuff is really big like that and just really hard to carry and seems like not enough people are sort of banding together to handle it, or you just, nothing sort of seems happening in your own immediate community, I think of Burning Man. Like, if there's something you want to see that's not there, guess what you get to do this year? And so I think I look at those kind of things as the same way. What the hell can you do? You know, can you start writing some letters? Can you start sending some money to somebody? You can do a lot of things, and gifting is all about what abundance you do have. Do you have some time to write a letter? Do you have a time to make a phone call? Do you have a time to start having a community meeting about some of this stuff? And there are other people that are out there looking to band together with you, but guess what? it's your turn to start doing some of that stuff and start trying to like make that happen, because otherwise you'll be upset about it and nothing will get done, and you know that'll be the end of it, and something else will happen and you'll be more upset. And so just take it on and take it as a challenge and take it as a something that, oh, this is an opportunity for me to give to somebody else, and I swear it will pay you back 100% every time.
I'd just like to add on to that a little bit by saying that I've noticed over the years that, in general, it takes a lot less energy for us to complain about circumstances than it does to actually do something about them. And it just seems to be human nature to just go, oh, man, that's terrible, or the government, or whatever it is. You know, it's like this big thing that we get to just, like, make our enemy or make this horrible thing. But I've noticed that the happiest people I know are the ones that are doing whatever they can. They're just doing something in their own little corner. It doesn't have to be taking, you know, saving the world, because really that is saving the world, in my opinion, is doing whatever you can do in your own little corner. That is saving the world. And I just want to say one other thought is about, like, transition. One thing I've noticed, like, in the beginning of being involved with transition is that I'd get this reflection from people. It's like, oh, you guys are like the doom and gloom, and you know, just the world's going to collapse. And there was this false perception about that. And there's this band of people, you know, the survivalists that are all piling up their stockpiles and everything for after the world is collapsed. And I remember thinking, it's like, If that's the world, if these are the people that are going to survive in the world, maybe it's better for me to go ahead and die with the rest of them. So.
We're close. Yeah. Don't worry. I thought it collapsed.
Maybe it is collapsing. This is, I mean, it is, isn't it? Right? We are in the collapse.
So I find this really fascinating. Thank you all, and really fresh. Thank you for that, in my mind, because I want to talk about positives. I don't want to hear about how everything's bad. I want to see what we can do about. Like, I love the idea of building a temple over Fukushima, getting the spiritual world going here, because that's what we need to do. But you know, it's all in the spirit realm. That's my experience. That's where it's at. So that's where we need to go, and that's what we need to do, and transition to that. But there's this painful healing process that we have to go through. It's just growth. My question is, though, what to do with people that you love that are just into substance abuse and pain relief because they can't deal, whatever, are in denial? Like, denial is huge. We get out of denial, then we're free. Then we get free. You know? Because then it just goes away, all that stuff that you, if you, you know, whatever.
You can go to, I think it's Al-Anon, which is family members of alcoholics. So you can go there and address the things that are bothering you there with other people who are other have family members that are alcoholics. In terms of taking judgment or trying to take an inventory of someone else, you can't do it.
Yeah.
You know, you gotta let that person's gonna have to make it on their own.
That's right.
You know, but you can go get help yourself, so you don't have to be, you know, a part of that problem. There's no voodoo out there. You know, you just don't.
It can be all kinds of other addictions, you know.
What was it he asked me earlier tonight? He said, how do you handle, what is it you said? It was great.
How do you handle, like, when you want to take a break and then you feel this pressure to keep making things?
Yeah. He said, he sat there for like 5 minutes in front of me and said, God, I don't know.
I look up to this man.
I have a question. this is the weirdest place I've ever been in. I mean, can you guys believe this? I mean, it's like we broke into this building. You know? I mean, look. I mean, isn't it weird? We're not supposed to be here, you know. I mean, it's really cool. I mean, you know, the idea, what you said, and I mean, now we're getting into the, you know, trying to get you guys sucked into painting the fence for me. But, you know, there's a man here who has the same name as me, David, who I met earlier, and he asked me something about working on a project, you know. And all the years of me working, and I mean, I've done a lot of work, you know, as an artist, and it's like one time I was doing a workshop in some university, and I had all these kids, and I said, okay, you form a team, okay, and you guys are going to pull the prints for her, okay? So they got a printing press. They would ink up the plate. She had the plate. One person inked up the plate. The other person pulled the print. At the end of the week, she had 25 prints, okay? And I said, now you pull the press for that person, okay? If you work as a team, you know, you just pull in a couple people, you can get stuff done, you know? And people love to work with one another, you know? I was in Detroit and, you know, all the people want to do in Detroit is work. You know, it's not about, you know, they need some more money. They just want to have goddamn self-respect and accomplishment. If you pull a bunch of people and start working, you know, you'll find it, you'll be able to pull people off the street, you know. So, I mean, the thing that I'm after is teams. I think, you know, with David asking me, well, how do you do it? And he's got a buddy next to him who's a guitar player, maker. Now, if there's someone else in this room that wants to jam with these two guys on building something in the desert, they're going to be out there, standing out there with a sign saying, we're fools and we want to go to Burning Man. And you can go and hook up with them. Or if... there's a woman in this building who takes care of abused horses, okay? If you want to meet her after this event, she'll be standing out there saying, I'm stupid, I work with horses. And you can work with her and help her. If you have a desire to help abused and battered horses, this woman here needs help on an alcohol substance abuse issue, or something, she's freaking out about what's going on there. If somebody here can help her out, plug in with her, okay? Start your own program. Hey, David, how are you?
Hi, my name's David. And I'm the guy that David was talking to earlier. So I've got a joke too. How many psychiatrists does it take to change a light bulb? Only one, but the light bulb has to really want to change. People ask me about substance abuse problems, and I say that, you know, it's an individual thing. That child might make it or they might perish, and you have to be okay with that. So the light bulb's going to have to want to change.
I actually would just like to tag on to what he was just talking about, because I think a lot of what we've been talking about here tonight and what a lot of we talk about all the time when we have these kinds of meetings with each other is change. You know, what resonated earlier with me was when Charles says, we all know, you know, we all have that inner knowing that something's wrong or something's right. And so how do we create that change? Because really, the thing that prevents us from changing and the things that causes addiction and all these other sorts of things is fear. You know, it's self-centered fear. And we talked about that a little earlier, when we're all of these selves and these little universes all bouncing around in fear that we're not going to have enough, you know, or that we're going to lose something that we think that we need. And so, you know, I think what you guys were talking about in the Burning Man, you know, gift and just go out and do stuff. And that's what Rob Hopkins was talking about last week in the Convergence. You know, the question that we constantly are finding that we're needing to ask ourselves is, you know, how do we actually transmit this information beyond ourselves? You know, those who innately are in touch with ourselves enough to realize that we know. You know, because so many of us in this society are programmed and desensitized, you know, in a way that just plays into the media, corporate, political, moneyed, you know, aspect of what's going on. And so I do believe, you know, that we are in a place today where things are potentially primed for change. And, you know, I think at a certain level, I know, I guess for myself, that just need to wake up every day and do the best I can to bring about that change in my life. But I'm just curious, from your all point of view, you know, how do you see this thing scaling up? You know, how do you see this thing growing beyond just our capacity to create greater levels of diversity with people who don't necessarily think the way we do and feel the way we do today?
I can start, I guess. My answer may not exactly nail that, but I come from a background of community farm workers down in Los Angeles for a while. When you talk about scaling up, you have to have a very good standard base. And I, with my own experience, feel that when you give a gift to someone, no matter what the gift is almost unimportant. The act of giving, I always say gift given is immediately gift received. Both of you are uplifted. It's not just the receiver. It's both of you are uplifted in that moment. You are breaking sort of a cycle. You're reaching outside of yourself. You're doing something different that changes that person's day. You have no idea what that's going to do. They may take that with them, and then they'll gift, and then the next person will gift. And it, they may not gift. It's hard to say. If you believe, like I believe, that all things are connected, you are making waves that a lot of people don't take the time to make in their daily life. If you do that on a daily basis, your life will change completely in the sense of you never know that. Like a friend of mine today came to see me. She met me on the playa. She brought me cookies. I fucking love cookies. That made my whole day. I have not had cookies all week. It's awesome. You know, and so you just have no idea. And when you talk about scaling up, well, if you think about if you started to do that and you started to talk about reaching outside of yourself and you started to live your life in the idea of I'm going to do something for somebody else every single day, well, that's going to grow. And your immediate community is going to change, and then the larger community will change. And so you have to kind of look at it as, what can I do in my backyard first? And that's how all grassroots movements start. That's how this country was formed. That's all of it. So that's where what I would say.
God, I just had the idea to get in my truck and run into someone's car and give them the finger and light some cigarettes and drink, you know. And I don't drink or smoke. You know? I mean, I don't know, you know. I'm not that nice of a guy, you know.
It's true. It's all right.
I mean, they're lucky I don't run into them.
I was going to say, in that sense, you don't have to be a nice person to do gifts every day, you know. Okay. So it's definitely not all the hippie stuff. Yeah, like, I'm not that nice either. My wife will tell you. Yeah, not a nice guy. No, no.
I just wanted to say one quick thing, and then I really want to hear what you have to say, is that I think that even talking about it in terms of scaling up might be the wrong languaging. Spreading out. It's like sort of like a mycelium network. We, through chain reactions of communities learning from each other, a spreading, a permeating, this fluid thing I call consciousness, is how, on a big scale, it's going to change, I believe.
David, I love it that you're not a nice guy.
What did you say to me?
Because
I can't hear a word you say.
I said, you're such a nice guy.
No, oh, I am.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, because like the reason to do gifting and stuff like that isn't so that you get to be a nice person.
Right.
You know, like that's part of this really old paradigm called the war against the self. You know, and like the real reason is, like you were saying about those guys in Detroit, they want to work. You know, you do it because you want to do it. And I don't want to see why you don't. Why do you say you're not like the gifting type when you like? Do you make like? Are you doing this to get rich? Yeah. You are.
Yeah, just had to work. Got
yeah.
Any other ideas?
I don't know. I'm working on that one.
I'm a nonprofit for a long time.
As for scaling up, I was in Istanbul speaking to people who were involved in the Gezi Park uprising, which happened. Like, okay, suppose, guys, we said, okay, we're gonna get 1 million people in the street in San Francisco to stay there for 20 days, and like, let's organize that starting tomorrow. Like, it's gonna happen tomorrow. Like, do we know how to make that happen? We don't know how to make that happen. We don't have enough money to pay people to come out there. We don't have organizational structure but that's what happened there. It happened almost instantaneously. It was something that nobody knew how to make it happen, but it happened. And so the question, it's not like, you know, let's come up with some plan to scale things up, but it's more, how do we create the conditions that things happen like that? I have another gifting story from Gezi Park. Every night, the police were coming in with tear gas, water cannons, you know, beating people up. You know, like it was like a battle every night, and the protesters are trying to keep them out, barricades, you know, and all that kind of stuff. But one night, or no, it was a couple nights actually. Somehow, this guy brought a piano onto the street there, and he played the piano all night. And those nights, and he had no plan about, you know, he had no reason, like, I'm going to do this so that this happens. But what happened those nights, the police were somehow paralyzed. They were unable to go and do what they had been doing every night, because I think what happened was that whatever story they were running about what's going on in the park, who these protesters are, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that story couldn't accommodate a piano playing all night. I'm done.
But that, like, there's these little stories that you hear about. Like, I just heard one recently. I think it's in England, where it's a regular thing now in some of these towns, where people go in, and when they buy a cup of coffee, they buy two more, and then those are just left on the books, and then homeless people can walk in and just say, can I have one of those coffees? And it's catching on, and so then other cafes are starting to do that, and that's what I mean about spreading out. Really good, and wow, it's something I can do, and it's easy, and it's only a cup of coffee. I only, you know, I'm only giving an extra $2, but I'm part of this thing that's happening, that feels good. And I think that's how.
The Sebastopol Cookie Company in Sebastopol on Main Street has such a program. So if y'all are in Sebastopol buying coffee in the morning, you can get a cup for Malcolm or Els or any of the other guys who live in the park and shower at the church.
Right on. I was getting really pissed off.
I was really getting pissed off at the microphone, and I was at Starbucks. I always go to Starbucks on my way to the dump, and there's this group of people that hang out by Starbucks, and, you know, it really makes you uptight. You know, you have to, you know, they put you a little guilt on you. And so finally, you know, because I always give people cash, but that was bugging me, because it was kind of my hangout, right? And finally, I went up to them, and I said, look, I'll give you $5, and I got a paper bag, and I said, if you just walk around and pick up some papers for me. You know, and they went and picked up the papers, filled the bag up, and I gave them $5. So they earned it. You know, it was like, I mean, it's not a great, profound discovery. I mean, you know, God, we all know these people like to work and like to get rewarded for it. But, you know, it was just, you know, the idea of you know, it took the bullshit off of me. I stopped being so negative about these guys. And it gave them the respect, you know. It's not about the dollars, you know, because I think we don't like money here, right? Oh, yeah, we do. We could go on all night with this one.
Charles, what could you say something about money and it as a form of gratitude? I mean, you don't advocate an economy without money.
No, why not?
Who said that?
I did.
So I don't know if you spoke on that or not.
You're the only one here that doesn't want any money. We're going to all give you all our money. I got $2.
I mean, what my book is about is reclaiming some parts of life from the money world, like a lot of things that we pay for.
$2.
Like, I kind of like your answer better, but I'm going to...
What was that answer? I don't know what the hell I said.
Well, maybe that's why I like it better.
God, you've done a great job on this thing tonight. I mean, it's incredible what you've done here, you know, by bringing this, you know, it just has made a whole lot of nice feelings come out of this place.
Well, that's...
You guys think I'm joking?
I thought you weren't nice.
No, it was really...
Yeah, funny. Well, thank you. Yeah.
No, I mean, I'm just watching this and thinking, what a nice experience.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. But let me finish that thought. Yeah. So, like, there's a lot of parts of life that many of us want to reclaim from the money realm. You know, there's something kind of obscene almost about paying people to perform intimate functions like cooking our food, growing our food, building our houses. You know, I mean, that used to be we have more and more of the things that can be quantified in our lives and less of the qualitative. The things we have less and less of the experience of someone serenading you. And how much recorded music do you have to buy to make up for the lack of that experience? So there's a lot of life we want to reclaim from money. Anything that can be done on a local scale, which is a lot of things. A lot of things have been globalized that should be local and can be part of a gift economy, need to be. But there's also a need to coordinate human activity on a global scale. And it's like in a body with billions of cells, trillions of cells, if a cell has a need of some sort, it puts a signaling molecule out into the body, into the environment, and then the other cells are like, oh, you need some of this, you need some of that, you know, we direct it your way. Ideally, what money should be is that kind of signaling molecule that allows needs to be met across vast social distances and allows coordination to happen. It's a conduit of information. Today, it's not working very well to do that. And in fact, it's driving the planet over a cliff and separating us, and the things that we want to get together and accomplish together that money should facilitate, we're unable to do those things because there's not enough money. Meanwhile, there's lots of money to do things that are killing us. So the system isn't working very well. So half of my book is about reclaiming money, reclaiming life from money. The other half is about changing money so that it is aligned with the things that are sacred to us. I agree with you, but maybe...
You're farther away from me because you're pissed off about money.
But hold on a second.
Anger, okay. Anger is an expression of getting rid of oppression. And when anger is a part of human nature to wake us up when we're being oppressed, I'm not angry.
Let Charles answer.
Let's Charles. Hear what Charles has to say.
Money doesn't have to be what it's been. money is a social agreement. Property is a social agreement too. Property ownership is a social agreement, right? The things that we supposedly own aren't attached to our bodies, but it's people, really what ownership is, it's people agreeing that a certain person has... So,
bring it back, please. Let's let Charles
let me just finish the thought, okay? Ownership is an agreement that says, for example, that you have the right to drive that sports car. We'll let you drive that racing car that you have, but not anybody else unless you allow them to do that. Mm-hmm. So, therefore, the shorthand for that is that we say you own that car. If in this country, if you own a piece of land, quote unquote, that means that you can keep other people off that land, and if they refuse to do it, men with guns will come and take them off the land. In some countries, ownership doesn't mean that. In some countries, ownership means that, like in England, for example, you're not allowed to keep people off your land. The land is considered to be the right of everybody to walk on, to pick berries, to camp on, even, like, right? So ownership means something different there. What if ownership was an agreement that says, for example, you have lived on this land for six generations, and we as a society, we as a community understand that you have a very deep and intimate relationship to this land, and we agree to allow you to make the choices about how this land should be best used in the service of all. That would be very, very far from what ownership or property is today. Right. So what I'm saying is that we need to change our agreements. Yeah, so, yes, and the agreement that we call money is the same. If we change the agreements, for example, the agreement that, I mentioned that already today, that you know, money is created by private banks as in the form of interest-bearing debt. What if money somehow returned to its original function as a token of gratitude, or...
But we don't need that. We can just give without the money. We don't need that.
Okay, well, let me just give... Well, I mean, I discuss this at length in my book, but let me just give one quick example, okay? So say that you are an engineer in Japan. You're a smart guy or a smart woman, and you have to decide, what am I going to do today? Should I spend the day playing video games or doing Sudoku puzzles? Or should I spend the day designing, I don't know, integrated circuits or something like that? There's lots of things you could do. And there's lots of things I can do with my time. And I would like to know what will best serve the world. How do I know that? Ideally, so there has to be some information system that tells us who needs our gifts and how much and what's the best use of our gifts. Ideally, money should be what money, I think, in a more beautiful world is. It's an information system that says yes, many people would love it if you spent your day designing solar panels or designing integrated circuits or finding a way to remediate toxic waste with mushrooms or something like that. Lots of people would love for you to do this. And this other thing that you might want to spend your day on playing World of Warcraft, that's not something that lots of people really want you to do. And so that's not, so ultimately money should be a kind of a coordinating and guidance system that guides the expression of people's gifts. That's very, very far from what money is today. I understand that. but we have to have, like, gift economy has never existed on more than a scale of, a few hundred families. The challenge before us today is to bring gift economy into a mass society with a global coordination of labor. Human activity, if you want to accomplish something beyond the power of your hands, you have to tell a story about it. And that enrolls other people. It gives them a role to play in the story, and it focuses human attention on one thing, the story of Burning Man. Like, without kind of a story about what this is, then it's insane for someone to drive off into the desert. You know, you only do it because it's Burning Man. You know, Burning Man is a story. So money and other symbolic systems are mediums of telling a story. Money is just symbols, really, just like language. And it's not, there are other ways to tell stories besides money. But, well, I think I'll leave it at that for now.
You also talked about money as a form of gratitude.
Read David Graeber about the origins of money. It's not as simple as gratitude. It's kind of a way to facilitate social relationships and stuff. It's he's my favorite anthropologist.
I think there's just one piece about this money thing that it hasn't been brought out that's important, which is that it is actually functioning as a form of measurement today. That is actually sort of the generic function of it. And what I find interesting is that there's really only one extant universal human language on the planet, that everyone from every culture, every level of wealth, every religious background, whatever difference you want to describe, and that's the balance sheet and the income statement. And those mechanisms, which were invented probably in China thousands of years ago, are used by everybody all the time, everywhere, because they actually help to measure facts, the objective facts of things. And so I just want to offer that as we imagine this other possibility, that we take measurement to another level. And I'll just leave all of you, most of you probably would never heard of this, but the reason that the CIA killed Salvador Allende is because he assembled a team of cyberneticians and they created a project to decentralize the entire economy of Chile. And they actually, it's called CyberSyn, and there's actually a book by Stafford Beer about it. But it actually showed how a decentralized, transition-oriented, valued system could run at a whole country level. And when it was ready to be up and running in 18 months, he was killed. And that was stopped. And those things have been stopped over and over again. So we do actually have some very well thought out models about how to measure in a way that focuses on people's gifts at the local level.
Thank you, Jan. We are, just heads up that we're already, we can get your question, but I just wanted to make sure it's okay with people that we keep going because we are over the time that we had said we would be going to. So obviously people are leaving if they need to. So we'll just take one more question and then maybe we'll have some closings.
Yeah, Caitlin's been waiting and waiting.
So good. It's so good.
Ask a question.
So so I think like what you were getting really passionate about, which was really beautiful, is kind of leading to this like bigger idea of like as people, individuals were changing. So, you know, the macrocosm reflects the microcosm kind of idea. So I'm wondering if you could talk about as like individuals and as a species, how that might be actually building us in strength towards making permanent changes. Does that kind of make sense? Yeah, I mean, I just think that all of us, you know, we feel like a deep unrest in our individual because we feel that that's happening in our environment. And our environment is changing, and everyone here is collectively, you know, pushing towards more positive change. And I don't know if, you know, maybe like individually before you committed to this, like maybe you felt lost or had addiction or, you know, whatever it is. Just,
I mean, I think that the process of like real change on a personal level happens in the same way that it happens on a collective level. There's a breakdown, you know, things are working pretty well for a while, you know, and every time I need to feel good, I can have a drink. And then that stops working very well anymore. And life falls apart. And I don't know what's who I am anymore. I don't know what's real. Don't know how things work. Everything that seems so real and permanent is revealed as just illusion. And that's happening to our society. I think both mirror the other, and I don't know how much more I want to say about that because it's late, but one thing I don't think is that we just need to work on ourselves as individuals and sit in caves and meditate, you know, and then personal change will magically cause the world to change. Like, yeah, I mean, there's some truth to, you know, if the universe reflects the self, then, you know, we can't really change because we're embedded, you know, identity is a social relationship, you know, where we can't really change if the world doesn't change. And if we do change, we're able to, then if you change one thing, you change everything. On the other hand, like, how do you change yourself? I mean, for me, it's through my relationships, you know, like if I'm sitting in a cave, there's not much of a problem, but if I'm, you know, out there, like talking to people and having intense interactions, you know, with maybe someone who's angry, and then like that brings up some anger in me, and then, oh, here's something that was hidden that's coming to the surface. So I think that the way to work on yourself is by working in the world. So I think that this kind of, you know, it's kind of a breakdown in the self-world division, and that's about all I've got to say. But I mean, here we have an expert on no, but
love, yeah. Cookies.
So let's have some kind of a closing remarks, and you can relate it to what is being talked about or whatever you'd like to say to close.
Okay, I'll try and keep it short. In my experience with my gift project and the daily giving, I found, like I said, it made me much less willing to be the victim of circumstance. That has changed my life completely. There are a few sentences that I write down to myself constantly to remind myself that I should keep doing this. One, giving happens everywhere. Two, gift given is immediately gift received. And three, what are you doing with the time that you have left? If you can answer that question honestly, that you're doing what you want to do with the days that you have left in your life, you're ahead of 90% of the people you know. So that's my closing bit.
David?
I was uptight coming here, right? I've been uptight lately about a lot of stuff. And I've just got a load of things on my mind. And when I came here, I felt better, you know, and I appreciate that you guys were here and made me feel better. And I think that's what you gave to me was your attention and your courtesy, and I thank you for that.
I feel really grateful to both of you. Yeah, and it was fun. And, you know, any revolution that's not fun isn't really worth having. So, yeah, thank you.
So, thanks. I want to just once again really express my gratitude to Charles for being here after a very long 6 days of, I think, a talk every single day and driving around everywhere. So I really appreciate your being here and being with us. And to David and to Joshua and to Heather and all the Burning Man people and the transition people, really great, and Lydia in this place and all, everybody that made it happen, all the volunteers, thank you. And I'll just leave with this thought. You know that old saying about, you know, oh, he or she thinks they're God's gift to the world? Well, just maybe that's not so bad. Maybe you are, you know, if you don't have to say God, but maybe you are the gift. And if you really saw yourself that way, I would imagine that we wouldn't need to hold on to very much else.